portable sound systems and would stand another 1,000. And it was filled almost every Sunday. One Sunday a month, the members could not attend. And they gave out tickets to the community, and people who could never get in because it was always full would fill it again that one Sunday a month. It was an amazing work of God. But Charles Haddon Spurgeon, he had a grandfather who was a great preacher, and he knew all the gospel and the spiritual truths, but he just wasn't saved yet when he was just about grown, and he was going to church regularly, and one Sunday a blizzard came, kind of unusual in that area of England, and he was making his way to the Baptist church, but the weather was too fierce, and he saw a little primitive Methodist church. And he just went into that small church and sat down at the back to get out of the weather and to hear what the pastor had to say there. Well, there was a handful of people, literally 12 or 15, his biographer, Richard Day Ellsworth, says in Shadow of the Broad Brim, a biography I've read several times about Spurgeon because it's just so personal, so written so close to his lifetime. And he said the minister couldn't even get there that Sunday they announced. So one of the men just volunteered to try to get up and speak off the cuff to the worshipers that were there. And he read out of Isaiah, "Look ye unto me, says the Lord, all ye from all the ends of the earth, and be ye saved." And he said the man obviously didn't know how to preach, and he didn't know what he's going to say, but he had a scripture, and he talked about every word of that scripture. "Look unto me." He didn't say we work for him and so forth. "Look unto me." Look to him, not to the church, not to baptism. "All ye into the word," not just certain bad people, but all of us, and that you might be saved. And you will be saved if you'll just look to him. He said he just said those things kind of over and over. And when he'd say, "Look unto me," he'd point that bony finger out. It would land on me every time out there on that last row of that little schoolhouse of a building. And he said, "I came under the most awful conviction I'd ever felt in my life. And at the same time, I said, that's it. That's it. Lord, I just need to look to you and quit striving and quit trying to be righteous. I just need to look unto you and you'll forgive me and cleanse me and save me." And he left that building, he said, lighter than air. His life was changed because he had trusted Jesus personally as his Savior. And the rest, they say, is history. He became this fantastic pulpiteer without a day's theological training in his life. One of the greatest theologians history has ever known, and simply a kingdom builder. He had a college in his church. He started over 200 missions in the London area in his 40-year ministry there at the Metropolitan Tabernacle. It's a fantastic story to read. God has a plan for people who will look to him, who will come to him, who will be saved, who will respond to that open invitation. There's another thing in the passage, though, that I